is 1 plus t to the b phi to the k sigma a of z, where here. Yeah, yeah, yeah. This is a capital phi, and this is a. Oh, sorry. That was just a problem. Okay. Then I also defined some psi operator, which was some left inverse to Frobenius, which commutes with gamma. Yeah. I also define the tete dual, of D. So depending whether you are in a torsion module or torsion free, it's a little bit different. I mean, either you go to torsion coefficients or to non-torsion coefficients. I'm sorry. And I proved that, in fact, this is isomorphic to the topological dual. Topological dual of D. So this topological dual is either the Pontryagin dual or the Ohm continuous into OL, depending whether you are torsion or torsion free. And so I have some things which goes from D check cross D to either OL, L mod OL or OL, and which satisfy two very important properties. So they are, I mean, this pairing is invariant with respect to the action of the semigroup here, P plus. And also, what is also important is that psi is the transpose of phi. So phi of x, y is equal to x psi of y. And same thing is you if you reverse, I mean, to put the phi on the second thing. And then finally, what I defined were sub. I mean, so some trellis inside. So D plus plus inside D plus inside D natural inside D sharp inside D. So these things are stable by phi, by constructions. These ones are stable by psi. And probably the most important property of this one is that it's where everything lands if you keep iterating psi. So more precisely, if you have M inside D, which is a trellis, then if you look at psi to the NM, then it is going to land into D sharp plus P of K D if n is big enough. Yeah, and the last thing is that this D sharp mod D natural is basically, I mean, it's very small. So it's isomorphic to D chech n. D is a fixed phi gamma module. And so if you look at mod P to the K, you get this. Okay. So this is inside the dual of that. And so it means that this is very small. And maybe to make a link with my first talk. So in my first talk, I had a torsion representation of GL2 of QP. And I define something which I'll call D plus W of pi. So this W, I remind you, is a finite length OL module, which is stable by GL2 of ZP and which generates pi. And then this was defined as the set of mu in the dual, such that mu mu is orthogonal to p to the n b 0 1 times w if well this b plus p to the n zp is not inside zp. And similarly, you could define a d natural w of pi, which would be the Pontryagin dual. So you take the sum for p to b plus p to the n zp inside zp, so the complement. Then you take the subspace generated by the translate of w. So if I recall you the picture with the tree, I take the part of the representation that lives on the tree corresponding to ZP. So I take only the open subset which are in ZP. And then I take its Pontryagin dual. And then there is a natural map, D plus W of pi, which is an injection into a D natural W of pi. And so I use this one to define a phi gamma module. And from this, you get D of pi, which was going to be OE, tensor OE natural, D plus W of pi. And you have a structure of phi gamma module here. And you can look at the image of D plus W of pi inside. Okay. And what you are going to get is that this is going to land. So D plus W of pi. It does not inject, I think. There is some T torsion that is killed when you do that. So it lands in D plus plus of pi. Well, let's put it in the other way. D of pi plus plus. And this D natural W of pi, in fact, it surjects on D natural of pi. Sorry, D of pi natural. W here, so it was something that I used to construct this module. So W is a finite length OL module inside pi, which is stable by GL2 of ZP, and which generates pi. Okay. So that's just to make some link with my first talk. Okay, so what are we going to do in the next two lectures? And before I do that, maybe I should point out that everything I said last time and this time can be read in Asterisk 330 and 330 in a paper which is called something like phi gamma module et représentation du mirabolique de GL2 de QP. Peut-être c'est dans l'autre sens, je ne sais plus. La représentation. OK. So what is your aim, global aim? The following. So we are going to construct two modules out of this. So we are going to construct something that I called D cross QP. So you start from any phi gamma module, and you are going to construct something which is called phi d cross qp. And this one is very easy. I will do it today. On which there is an action of the mirabolic, which I define, like, denote by p of qp. And then if you choose a delta, a character from qp star to OL star, so continuous character, then I will define something that I will call d cross delta of p1, so p1 is p1 of qp, with an action of g, L2 of qp, so g is gl2 of qp. And I will also define something which is almost an isomorphism, so meaning that the kernel is very small, and the co-kernel is also quite small, I think. I don't know about the co-kernel. Anyway, the kernel is small, which is going to the restriction to QP. And this map is going to be equivariant for the action of the mirabolic. And so, ultimately, what we are going to be interested in is a case of dimension 2 and delta is well chosen. Then there will be something which is going to be stable by G inside here. So, and this thing is going to be this D natural that appears, I define here, cross P1. So meaning the subset of elements where, I mean, for which the coordinates are in this D natural. And here you will get the representation of GL2 of QP that you want, pi of D. And this kernel here is going to be isomorphic to pi of D tensor some character, pi of D dual tensor some character. And this is supposed to be an echo of the following exact sequence that we use plentiful, I mean, that we saw plentifully, which is the fact that if you start with OE here, you have an exact sequence where you have the dual of continuous functions on ZP. And here you have the continuous functions. OK, so that's the plan. So let's start. So the idea here is that you have something, a phi gamma module that lives on ZP, and we want to construct element, I mean, we construct modules living on QP or P1, QP to have an action of the of the mirabolic, and P1 to have an action of GL2 of QP. Okay, so let's do it. And so I know only one way to do this kind of thing is to look at measures and try to see if what I can do with measures can be extended to any phi gamma modules. So let's start with measures. So measures on QP, or distributions on QP. So by definition, a distribution on QP, mu, distribution on QP, well, this is an element of the dual of locally analytic functions on QP with compact support. And for measures, you just replace locally analytic by continuous functions. And if you have such an element here, you can define mu n, which is a distribution on ZP, which is just basically the restriction to p minus nzp. So it's defined in the following way. The instruction on the integral of zp of phi mu n is equal to the integral over p minus nzp of phi of p to the nx mu. Okay, so what you do, you take the restriction to p minus nzp and you just change variable to go back to zp. And so you get a family of distribution in this way. And so you see what is going to happen. So to go to p minus nzp to p minus n minus 1 zp, and when you move back to zp by multiplying the variable by p to the n, you're going to get that the restriction to pzp of mu n plus 1 has something to do with mu n. Okay? And so what you actually get is the following formula, is that psi of mu n plus 1 is equal to mu n for all n. Where psi, I remind you, is just, in this case, p minus 1, 0, 0, 1, together with the restriction to pzp. And vice versa, if you have such a sequence, this gives you a distribution on qp. And vice versa. Okay. And so now you can ask yourself, well, how do I encode usual actions? So now assume you start from measures on QP with value in OL. Then this is the same thing as a sequence of mu n in d0 of zp with value in OL, which satisfy this property. And you can use Amis transform to define the Amis transform of such a thing. And you define the Amis transform of mu to be the sequence of the Amis transform of mu n. Okay, so it's just a sequence. And now the question is, well, I mean, because in I'm going to go back to distribution at some point, but here I want to speak about phi gamma modules over OE. So it just and so on this space here, you have a natural action of the mirabolic, which is the usual. You have the integral over QP of I phi of x A B 0 1 mu, which is just the integral of phi of ax plus b mu. And now the question is, how do you describe this action in terms of the Amis transform? And the answer is very, very easy. Is that, well, if you plug in 1 plus t to the x in there, what you get is the following. Is that, so and this I call in this way, because otherwise it's really horrible. So a n of 1 b 0 and mu, well, this is just a multiplication by 1 plus t to the p to the n b. But this is true only if n is big enough. So if p to the n zp, p to nb is in zp. And I just want to point out is that if you know a n mu for n big enough, you know it also for the others, because you just have to apply psi. Okay. Same if you apply a 0, 0, 1 mu, then you get that it is sigma a of a n mu for all n. And finally, when you apply p to the k, a n p to the k 0, 0, 1 mu, then this is just a shift. So it's a mu n plus k if n plus k is bigger than 0. So you have a nice construction of I mean, you have a nice way of describing the action of the parabolic on measures just using the phi gamma action. And the only thing you are using are psi and the action of 1 plus t here and sigma a, OK? Yeah, maybe I skip that. And so you can generalize this in the following setting. So you define what a p of zp psi module is. So p of zp is the parabolic, but the zp point of the parabolic, so zp star, zp 0, 1. So what you want is an action. So it's a topological module M. So a module M. So it's going to be a topological module, OL module, plus a continuous action of P of ZP, and psi. So you want that psi commutes to the diagonal matrix. So psi commutes to ZP star. And you want that it almost commutes with the unipotent, but you have a multiplication by p. So you want that psi, when you apply 1 pb 0, 1, then this is the same thing as 1 b 0, 1 psi. And so the basic example would be just the measures on ZP with the usual actions. So that's a basic example. And the next examples are examples d naught of ZP with value in OL. Then more generally, you would have any phi gamma module, which would be a phi gamma module in torsion, so etal phi gamma module, either torsion or torsion free.
Where do you use etal?
Etal you use because you need a psi. And so you need that, and you need also, I mean, so, and then you can also use D natural or D sharp. They satisfy all these conditions. So when you have such a thing, well, you can define M cross QP to be the set of sequence XN, N in N, such that psi of XN plus 1 is equal to xn for all n. And then on that, there is a natural action of P of QP now, given by exactly these formulas. So maybe I put a 2-star. And you replace A n by xn and PQP via formula 2-star. So Marie-France Vigneras claims that I'm just constructing some induced representation from from a semi-group to the group. Anyway, I need the explicit formulas, so. Okay, so now if you have on top of everything, if you have a phi, then you can get do many more things. So I define now what I call a P of ZP phi psi module. So it's a so you assume that you have already a P of ZP psi module, and you have on top a phi. So you want the phi. So this is a P of ZP psi module plus a phi which is supposed to be injective. You want it to commute to a gamma, so phi A001 is equal to A001 phi. You want it to give you a Figaro module, so you want that when you apply phi and B001 first, then you get the same thing as 1PB01 phi. And then the last condition, which is very important, is the following. Don't know what happened, but. So the last condition is the following. So you want that when you apply psi 1B01 and phi. So if you put P equals 0, I'm just going to ask that psi is an inverse to phi. But more generally, I want the following thing. I want that you get 0 if B is in ZP star. And you want to be it 1. P minus 1 B 0 1 if B is in PZP. Yeah, so these two conditions here gives you an action of P plus. And this condition here gives you the following decomposition. Yeah, so I think I also have to assume that. You want that, OK, sum from I equals 0 to P minus 1 of 1i 0, 1, phi psi 1 minus I 0, 1. This is equal to the identity. So I remind you that this operator here is the operator I called restriction to I plus PZP. So what you can prove from this formula is that this is a projector. And the formula that is here gives you that these projectors are mutually orthogonal, which is here. And then the last thing that you want is that they form the decomposition of identity.
Are there two i's?
Two i's. Ça, c'est des i.
Yeah,
Okay, so the basic example, as we saw already, is the measures on ZP. And you can also take any figure module D. But you cannot take D natural or D sharp, but not D natural and D sharp, because these are not stable by Frobenius, usually, except in very, very, I mean, this one is never, and this one is almost never. Okay, so once you have this kind of object, well, you can define the restriction to any open subset in the following way. So you define, as before, the restriction to A plus P to the N ZP if N is an integer and A is in ZP to be just 1 A 0 1 phi N psi N 1 minus A 0 1. And there is a small lemma which tells you that this, I mean, just with this formalism, that these maps behave the way you want them to behave, meaning that the restriction to A plus P to the N ZP is equal to the restriction to B plus P to the N ZP if A minus B is in P to the N ZP. So that's nice. And the second thing is that you have a decomposition, just using this one, telling you that if you decompose A plus P to the NZP in things mod P to the N plus 1, you get what you want. So I equals 0 to 1, P minus 1 of the restriction to A plus P to the NI plus P to the N plus 1 ZP. This is equal to the restriction to A plus P to the NZP.
Can one tell that one construct a phi from Q to P with phi secure?
Yes, exactly. That's what we are doing. We have constructed a phi on Q to P, a phi of I don't know what kind of module, just OL module, let's say. And so it satisfies that, and it also satisfies what you would think, saying that And so because you have this second decomposition, then you can define the restriction to any open compact. So define a restriction to U for any U open compact of ZP now. And this restriction satisfies exactly what you would think it satisfies, namely, let's put it. Put the first thing, the restriction to U plus the restriction to V is equal to the restriction to U intersected with V plus the restriction U union V. If you apply the restriction to U after having applied the restriction to V, then you get the restriction U intersected with V. And maybe something which is not, that you also expect, but you have to verify it, is that if you take an element G in P plus, then you have that G applied to the restriction to U is equal to the restriction to GU applied to G. So that's what you say. We are constructing a sheaf which is equivalent. I mean, now it's equivalent for the action of P plus, and then it will be equivalent for the action of B. And finally, so everything was on M here. So M is our phi psi module, and now we want to go to M cross QP. So we embed M inside M cross QP just by sending an element x here to the sequence of the phi to the nx. And because psi phi is the identity, you really get an element of m cross qp. And you denote by m cross zp the image. And now what you do is that if you have a u inside qp, which is compact open, then you choose k in n such that p to the k u is inside zp. And then you just define the restriction to u to be so first I should tell you that there is a restriction to zp going from m cross qp to m cross zp. And if you have a sequence xn here, then you just send it to iota of x0. Over zp. Exactly. That's exactly what I'm doing. So the restriction to u, well, is this just what you think it will be. So you take the restriction to p to the ku, apply, so you take p to the minus k 0, 0, 1, restriction to p to the ku, which is defined because p to the ku now is inside zp. And then you just apply p to the k 0, 0, 1. And this is good. And yeah. And this is going to give you something. And then you get exactly the same properties as here. But now the g does not have to be in p plus. It's in p of qp. And so get same properties. As above. But g can be in p of qp. Okay, so I mean, in particular, we have constructed d cross qp, d natural cross qp, d sharp cross qp. And so, for example, the one thing, so if you start from m equals d naught of zp with value in OL, what you get m cross qp, well, this is just equal to to d naught of qp with value in OL and with the action of p of qp that I started with. You can take D as well as D0 if you want. But that's not, yeah, that's not what you should do. But you can. It's a little bit too big. Okay, so now, I mean, once you have this, you have also things with compact support. So you define m. Yeah, maybe I should say that I define m cross u. M cross u is the image of this projector restriction to u. So it's a sub thing. And you can extend by 0. So restriction to u of m cross qp. And so here again, if you start from this thing, what you are going to get are measures on the open set U, extended by 0 outside. So now what do you define? M cross QPC. So this means things with compact support. and it's just the union over all n of m cross p minus n zp. I view this one as a sub module of this one, just by extension by zero outside. Which one?
U
is open compact.
Ah.
No, if it is not, I don't know what to say about. So this thing is stable by P of QP. Just because the image of a compact open by P of QP is still compact open. And there is one thing that is a little bit useful, is that, so what kind of topology do you put on this thing? You're supposed to put the product topology. Yeah, I erased the definition of M cross QP, but M cross QP is it's a set of sequences, and so you put the product topology. And in this topology, you have that if you take any element x in M cross QP, then you can approach it by element with compact support. X is the limit when n goes to plus infinity of the restriction to p minus n zp of x. Okay, and then finally, so if now we can speak of these things, d cross QP for any phi gamma module, d natural cross QP and d chetch cross QP. So these are the correct things to consider in case you have an OL module. So, okay, if D is an OE module, OE phi gamma module, if D is a phi gamma module over E, these things are too big. And so what you do, you just choose a lattice in there, and you extend scalar. So what you do is you choose d naught in phi gamma module étale of OE, such that d is equal to d naught 1 over p. So you just extend scalar from L to OL. And then instead of looking at d cross QP, what you do, you define d cross QP B. B for bounded to be, you start from D naught cross QP, and then you extend the scalar to P. Okay? And same with D natural and D sharp. And why do you do that? So if you start from the measures on ZP, so here it means measures with value in L, okay? So there is no integral structure. Then what you get, if you start from a d0 of zp and don't put a b, then you're going to get a dual of continuous functions with compact support. It's very big, extremely big. If you do the same thing here, cross QP with a B, what you're going to get is continuous, it's bounded measures. So it's going to be the dual of continuous functions that go to zero at infinity. So you have a much bigger space on which you can evaluate your thing. So it's continuous functions on QP with go to zero at infinity, and then you take the dual. So it's much smaller, and so you can integrate against much more functions. Okay, so finally, there is some duality, as always. So there is an equivariant pairing. So you take an element in D chesh cross QP, and you take, so maybe before I say anything, so here you have all these restriction maps, okay? But here you don't, because there is no phi. You cannot, I mean, it will not be stable by restriction maps. So you have to be a little bit careful when you say something. So if you take the restriction to U of an element here, well, it's not an element of this anymore. I mean, it still exists. Right? It's still an element of D cross QP, but it's not an element there. So you have to be a little bit careful. Now, if you take an element in X, in D chesh cross QP, an element X, Y in D cross QP, then you would like to pair them and get a number. So it's impossible. So, but if you take things with compact support, then you can. And the way you do it, you choose n big enough such that p to the n 0, 0, 1, x is in D chesh cross zp. And same with y. And this you call xn. This you call yn. And then you define x, y, qp to be just xn, yn for n begin for n any n big enough. And this is not going to depend on choice of n, because when you replace n by n plus 1, then you will get a phi of xn here, phi of yn here, and our pairing was invariant under phi. So and so this pairing that you construct here is equivariant with the with respect to the action of the mirabolic is equal to xy if g is in the mirabolic. And finally, there is one property which is very important, is that so that's the first property of this pairing. The second property of this pairing is that you have x, y, which is identically 0 if you have each x, which has support in U, y, which has support in V, and if U inter V is the empty set. And so see, there is some kind of localization of this pairing, which tells you that D chesh cross U is the dual of D cross U. Topological dual of D cross U. So it's some kind of very strange. X minus y. So some kind of integral of x minus y over QP. Yeah, it's some kind of Dirac measure at zero of but I mean I don't know what how it looks like really, but I mean there is this property that tells you that if you restrict to an open, then the dual is just a restriction of the dual to this open. A little bit strange.
I was thinking that you were getting for each compact open in QP some inner product, and that it was an additive function of compact open.
This is true, yes.
Yeah.
Well, no. No, I mean, so what I find a little bit miraculous is that it's really additive and compact open.
So it means one has a very
Yes, L or L.
Some kind of measure.
Well, I don't know exactly how to interpret it better than what I wrote on the board, but okay, so that's the first thing. So one thing which is important is that if you look at this D sharp cross QP, then there is a second description of it. So it's a set of sequence xn such that xn plus 1, sorry, xn is equal to psi of xn plus 1. That's for any element in D cross QP. But it's a set of bounded sequence. So it's a set which for xn bounded in D. So no, it's a property. So the only thing that is not clear is that, so what is clear is that if you have something which is in there, then it is bounded because D sharp is a trellis, and so bounded means contained in a compact. I mean, okay. So there is one inclusion which is clear, and what is not clear is that if you have a sequence of which is bounded and which satisfies this, then automatically the sequence takes value in D sharp. But this is what the property of D sharp I told you is that it receives anything that is. I mean, if you apply psi sufficiently many times to something, then you land into D sharp. What? Excuse me? It's true whether D is torsion or none. And that's a very useful description of D sharp cross UP. And there is one other thing that you should notice is that D psi equals 1. Well, this is inside the D sharp cross P1. QP, and it just takes a constant sequence. And I remind you that this one is related to the Galois cohomology, to the Iwasawa cohomology of the Galois representation attached to V. So this is result of Fontaine. Yeah, and so maybe I should point out something. So the one that we are really interested in is this one. And the one which has, no, sorry, yeah, so I have two here. So the one that we are really interested in is D natural cross QP. And the one which has the best properties because of that is D sharp cross QP. And so it is important to understand how big is the difference. So there is this restriction map, Zp, which goes, which induces a map from D sharp cross QP to D natural mod D natural cross QP. And then when you restrict to Zp an element of D sharp, by definition, you get an element of D sharp mod D natural. So you have a map like that. And this map is an isomorphism. It's very easy to prove. And this one is very small. So it means that this one is very small. Okay. So I mean, this is a troublesome small module, but it's you can deal with it. So it's small. So that's one thing. And in particular, for example, so it's small. And in particular, if, let's say, D is irreducible of rank bigger than 2, I mean, we are going to be interested in a case rank 2, OK? And then this module here is, in fact, OL torsion module. Then D sharp mod D natural is an OL torsion module. OL module, well, it's even an OL module of finite length. So it means that, up to multiplying by a fixed power of p, then you can just ignore it. Okay. So now what are the main properties of these things? So basically everything I told you up to now is purely formal. Except for this thing here, which is not purely formal, but not so difficult. And so the theorems are the following. So the first thing is that this functor d goes to d sharp cross qp. This is an exact functor. So this is just a little bit surprising, because if you remove this cross qp here, it's not exact at all. It's really a catastrophe. So the second thing is that if you take any m inside d sharp cross qp, and you assume that it is closed and stable by the mirabolic, so closed, stable by the mirabolic, then you don't have so many possibilities. Then this implies that there exists a D1, a sub-phi gamma module. So it's a sub-phi gamma module such that your M is, so contains D1 natural cross QP inside the M, and it is contained in D1 sharp cross QP. And because the difference between these two is very small, that gives you a very small number of possibilities for this M. So for example, if you start from, let's say, the trivial module, Ke, so start from the residue field of OE, then this is the same thing as taking measures on ZP with value in OL. Then what you get is that if you look at the measure on QP with value in KL, residue field, this is topologically irreducible as a P of QP module. It's topologically irreducible as a P of QP module.
D1 is
etal, yes. Yeah. No, there is a sub etal phi gamma module. And anyway, I think that any sub phi gamma module of something over OE is going to be etal. I don't see how it could be false. It's etal over OE, not OE. It's not over the row bearing. Over the row bearing is completely false. But here you have something integral, so. Yeah, and so one corollary of this, which is going to be useful, is that if you take D in phi gamma etal of E, which is irreducible of dimension 2, let's say, or bigger than 2, irreducible of dimension bigger than 2, then what you get is that this D natural cross QP B, so I remind you what this B means. It means that you take a lattice and then you attain scalar. Okay. So this one is going to be topologically irreducible as a P of QP module. As a P of QP module. And this is exactly what we are going to use So this will imply the fact that the representation P of di, d, I mean, pi of d that I will construct, this one is topologically irreducible. So because what we are going to prove is that it's already irreducible as a P of QP module. So it will be, I mean, a fortiori irreducible as a G module. So that's the main ingredient to prove that. And just before taking a pause, let's give you the last theorem. Is that if you have two phi gamma modules, D1 and D2, and which are isomorphic, so such that D1 natural cross QP is isomorphic to D2 natural cross QP, as topological P of QP module, P of QP modules, then the conclusion is that D1 and D2 are already isomorphic as phi gamma module. So I will spend the next hour explaining how you prove this kind of thing. But what is the consequence for periodic local Langlands? Well, it is going to tell you that what you're going to construct is an injection, so meaning that the pi of D1 is isomorphic to pi of D2 if and only one D1 is isomorphic to D2. That's what you will get. So injectivity of periodic local Langlands. And in fact, you get something much stronger that's in injectivity because, as you can see, the construction of this module only uses the mirabolic, does not use G, L2 of QP. So what you get is injectivity of periodic local Langlands even when you restrict to the mirabolic. Okay, so we want to prove such a statement. And how do we do that? We are going to construct a functor going in the other direction. And so I'm going to define some subset. So what I'm going to define is something called D cross QP PC. So PC stands for presque compact. And so it's a set of So D here is a phi gamma module, a netal phi gamma module. Phi gamma module over OE. And so this includes torsion and torsion free, okay? And so I define this inside of D of cross QP. So it's a set of Z such that when you look at 1, B, 0, 1, Z, then this goes to 0 when B goes to infinity. So there is something you can prove rather easily, is that this D cross QP PC contains D cross QPC. And yes, so it's a convergence in the product topology. So it's restricting to any compact set. And so, well, basically you should see that it is zero at infinity, because when you translate it, then what you are bringing back for infinity is small. That's what you're saying, okay? Okay, and so what kind of object it is? Well, it is a sub-module. So D cross QP PC is a sub-P of QP module of D cross QP. And I want to describe it completely in other terms. And that's exactly what is going to allow us to recover D. And when you do that, well, you construct the inverse functor. So for that, I have to speak about the trivial phi gamma module. So some more rings. So I'm sorry for the notations, but I don't know how to do it. So inside of OE, so OE is a ring of Lorentz series with coefficients in OL. Okay. Inside it, I take the rings, the Lorentz series with coefficient in ZP. So Lorentz series I'm going to forget this one very soon, but I need it just. So the residue field, which I call OQP, is just going to be FP double bracket T instead of being KL double bracket T. And so now I take the completion of its radical closure. So this is completion of radical closure. So basically what I want to do is from this ring I construct a ring on which phi is going to be invertible and it will be complete. So I just give you the construction. So tilde always means that phi has been made invertible and it is complete. Okay. So on it, you have actions of, well, maybe let's go to W. So we define A tilde of QP to be the ring of vit vectors with value in A tilde QP. And so this comes with an action of gamma, because here you just have an action of gamma. When you just extract P to the nth root, it's not going to change the action of gamma. And you have a Frobenius, because you have a Frobenius everywhere. And and this ring here contains AQP, naturally, together with its action of phi and gamma. So I have to explain to you what becomes T in this ring, okay? So first, let me remind you that any element x in A tilde of QP can be written in terms with Teichmuller representative. So this means Teichmuller representatives here. And so the T which is here is really going to be equal to the Teichmuller representative of 1 plus t bar minus 1. So what do I mean by that? I just mean that that's what I want. So t bar is just the t downstairs. And what? Yeah, it will be a t-bar. Okay. I just put it very, very small and you forget it immediately. Okay, so. And on this one, there is a t-bar, yes, and so you forget it. So if you look, phi of t is really going to be with this one to the power p, so it's 1 plus t to the p minus 1, and sigma of t, it's also sigma I is going to raise this to the power a, and so you're going to get the initial formulas. And the way you go from here to here, as I say, you just make phi invertible, Frobenius invertible, and then you complete for the periodic norm. And then you define O tilde E just to be OL tensor over ZP A tilde QP. And this is going to contain OE. Yeah, and maybe I also need OE tilde. Well, let's put natural, which is just OL tensor ZP of W of, well, you take the ring of, well, maybe I put a plus here. I mean, there it's the same. Of E tilde QP plus, and this is a ring of integers. So this is stable. So it's a sub ring of this one, which is stable by phi and gamma. Yeah, and you can also describe it as a set of elements in O tilde E, for which when you apply Frobenius, it stays bounded. The same. Okay. So I remind you that we have a nice interpretation of this ring instead of in terms of periodic functional analysis. Well, it is the same for these rings and this one. So I'm just going to give you this interpretation. So for this, I need some periodic analog of Fourier transform of x goes to e to the 2 pi I x. So in fact, in periodic, we have two analogs. So the first one, first analog is the following. You can send x to Teichmuller of 1 plus t to the x. And what do I mean by that? So x, you can write as p minus n a, where a is in zp. So x here is an element of qp, OK, on qp. And so this is just going to be, so this is Teichmuller, and 1 plus t to the x, by definition, should be phi minus n of, well, phi minus n is just x to the p minus n of 1 plus t to the a. So 1 plus t to the a is just defined by the usual power series. Okay. And so something which is important to notice is that if x is in zp, then this 1 plus t to the x is actually equal to our old 1 plus t to the x because of the identification that we made here. Okay, but this is completely false if x is not in zp because the series is not going to converge. False if x does not belong to qp. So it's much more subtle. In ZP, sorry. No, it is not meaningless. I mean, it does not converge, but you could embedded into something where it would converge, but it would give the wrong answer. Well, you can put everything in Bidoram plus, and this has a perfect meaning in that case. And you are going to get the wrong answer. And the second thing is that, yeah. I mean, this T is supposed to be epsilon minus one, okay? So. Well, anyway, that's the wrong thing to consider, so it's better not to speak about it. And then there is a reduction map going from O tilde E plus to, so I should not do that. If you go from A tilde QP plus, which is the same thing, where you don't, you did not extend the scalar to OL. Then there is a map theta, which is Fontaine's map, to, you start. So F infinity is a cyclotomic extension of QP. Okay, then you you complete it. And this map theta, which is really Fontaine's map, is just, in this case, it's a reduction modulo the following element. So how do I call it? Well, I don't give it a name. Well, T over 1 plus T to the 1 over P minus 1. Usually I call it omega, but which is also T over phi minus 1 of T. Okay, and the second thing that you can look at is the map X goes to theta of 1 plus t to the x. And now this is going to be with value in mu p infinity. And this one is really the classical analog of x goes to e to the 2 pi I x, because if you take an element in zp, so it's a morphism from qp to mu p infinity. If you take an element in zp, you're going to get 1. And so this is x goes to e to the pi 2 pi I x bar, where x bar belongs to qp mod zp, which is inside q mod z. And then you have chosen some isomorphism between, I mean, you have chosen some embedding of. of algebraic numbers in QP and QP bar, in C and QP bar, okay? But the one you really want to look at for periodic Fourier transform is this one. Yes. So now we are going to use the first one, okay? But so the second one is also very useful when you do usual periodic Fourier transform. So when we are going to speak about locally algebraic representations, then this is the second one that is going to come naturally in the Kirilov models and things like that. So and the fact that you can get it by just reducing mod theta is also important. So. Okay, so what should I say exactly? yeah. So before I okay, so before I state the theorem, let me remind you something about normalized trace maps. No, so normalized Tate's map, Tate's trace maps. So these are maps that are going to allow us to go back from O tilde I to OE. So let's fix a set of representative of QP mod ZP. So set of representatives of QP mod ZP can be whatever inside QP. So you write I as a union of IN. And IN is a set of representative of P to the minus N ZP mod ZP. So IN isomorphic to P minus N ZP mod ZP. And so you have a very simple lemma, which tells you that the first thing is that the 1 plus T to the I for I in IN are basis of phi minus n of EQP over EQP. So this is completely trivial. And the consequence is that when you complete, you get that any element, so any x in tilde QP can be written uniquely. So x can be written uniquely in the following way. Sum I in I of AI of x, 1 plus t to the I, where the AI of x are in EQP, and they go to 0 when I goes to infinity. Okay, and then you get the same thing when you lift up. So any x in O tilde E can be written in the same way. The only thing here is that you put Teichmuller of 1 plus T to the I here. And the AI of x here are going to be in OE. And moreover, x is in O tilde E plus if and only if all the AI of x are in O E plus, which is the same thing as O E natural for all I. So this is basically trivial. And then from there, you can define some normalized trace maps in the following way. So you define the restriction to P minus N ZP of X to be the sum of I in IN of AI of X times 1 plus T to the I. And what you get is the following things. So these maps have the usual properties of normalized state maps. So they commute with gamma. Commutes with gamma. What do they have? It is phi minus n of OE linear. Phi minus n of OE linear. One important thing is that when you apply it to an element x, well, this is the limit of its restriction maps. Limit when n goes to plus infinity. And that's about it. No, it does not depend on choice of capital I. The way you write it, the AI of X, of course, depends on choice of capital I, but the maps here do not depend on choice of capital I. There is one another way to write it. So if you want, what you can also do is, inside O tilde E, you have the union of the phi minus n of OE. Okay, and now the restriction map here is just the trace down to this thing divided by P to the n. So the restriction to P minus n ZP of some element x is 1 over p to the k times the trace from phi minus n plus k OE over OE over phi minus n OE of x for all k big enough. So this is true in this sub-ring, and then it's true by continuity. Okay, so using this, in fact, you can describe the things that I call D0QP OLPC. So D0 OLPC, it's a special case of the construction I gave before. And if you spell it out, it's the same. You're just asking that for all phi with compact support, let's say, then you should have that the integral over QP of phi of x plus b mu goes to 0 when b goes to infinity. So that's the condition. And so what does the theorem say, or the proposition? So it gives you a way of thinking about this object. It has a Fourier transform. Mu goes to the integral over qp of 1 plus t to the x. Well, this is going to converge exactly for the mu which are in there. So you just take the integral of a bigger and bigger sub, bigger and bigger open subset of QP. Well, this induces an isomorphism. D 0 of QP OL PC isomorphic to O tilde E plus. And in this isomorphism, the restriction to P minus N ZP commute. So commuting. With rest P to minus N ZP maps. So that's the first part of the proposition. And then the second part is that, well, you can extend this residue at zero map by continuity. And then you can define, so if you have any element z in O tilde I, you can define the function phi z of x, which is the residue at zero of 1 plus t to the minus x z dt over 1 plus t. So I have to tell you how you define this. So you just define it by this formula in for this subfield, this subring here, using the fact that it was invariant by Frobenius. So I remind you that if so we had this formula, residue at zero of phi of f dt over 1 plus t is equal to residue at zero of f dt over 1 plus t. So we had this formula for f in OE. So if I have an element in this subring here, it means that I can apply phi to the n phi sufficiently many times to land into OE. And so then I can really apply this formula, and I get something that does not depend on the choice of n. So this gives me a well-defined map on this thing, and then I can extend it by continuity to the whole thing. So I have a map like this, and this is going to give me, so z goes to phi z, is an isomorphism between, so O tilde I modulo O tilde I plus isomorphic to, continuous functions on QP with value in OL, but which tend to zero at infinity. So the zero here means that phi z of x goes to zero when x goes to infinity. And so I'm not giving the proof, but it is the direct consequence of the existence of the AI of x. The AI of x are going to give you the restriction to I plus P to I to ZP, and because they go to zero, that's exactly translated in this term. Okay, so that's the case of the trivial module. And so as you see, what we have done was going from ZP to QP, basically. We had exactly the same kind of statement for ZP, for OE. And so it's part of the philosophy that the phi gamma modules live on ZP, but there is something else that lives on QP, and which is given by, well, I will give a more precise statement now. Okay, so we did the case of the trivial module. Now we start from any module. So we start from a D, which is a phi gamma module of OE, and we define D tilde to be just the extension of Kähler . And now the main difference is that phi is bijective on d tilde. Main difference is that phi is bijective on d tilde. Inside of d tilde, I define d tilde plus to be the set of x in D tilde such that phi n of x is bounded in D tilde plus, in D tilde, sorry, phi n of x for n in n is bounded. So what I want is no denominators in T. Yes.
You related E to D0 and C0, and now you're...
No, I had two exact sequences. I had the one at the integral level, so OE with continuous functions with value in OL, and measures with value in OL, and the same thing with E, where the continuous function with values in L and the measures with value in L.
Right, but now OE tilde is bigger.
OE tilde plus is bigger, but now you have measures on QP.
Oh, now you're measuring on QP.
Yeah. I mean, it's always the same thing. It's you start with something which lives on ZP, and then you do a lot of things, and you get to something that lives on QP. And yeah, and by the way, I don't think this is a dual of anything reasonable. So, well, at least I don't see anything reasonable for which it would be the dual of. But this, no, I don't. No. As you will see, in fact, the dual of this one. What is it? So you have continuous functions that goes to zero at infinity. So its dual are just going to be the measures on QP, bounded measures on QP. Okay. So the dual of this one. The dual of this one is what I called OE dagger cross QP. Okay, and it will be a general statement. So what do I really want? Okay, so I define this object. Okay, and now I can, in fact, just describe what they are. So there is a natural action of P of the mirabolic. And here it's just PKA B 0 1 Z. Well, it's the same formula as before, except that you have, instead of 1 plus T to the B, you have to put Teichmuller here. And then phi to the K sigma A of Z. And here K can be anything in a Z now, because phi is bijective. And you have so you have normalized state trace maps here, okay, and so you get normalized state trace maps on this one, so you get res p minus 1 p minus n zp, which go from d tilde to phi minus n of d just by linearity. So this phi minus n of d has to be interpreted as phi minus n of o e tensor over o e d. And this gives you, so if you have an element z in d tilde, then you can look at the sequence of its restrictions. So you look at the phi to the n restriction to p minus n zp of z. So this is a sequence of elements in d now. Okay, and in fact, what you prove easily is that this sequence is an element of d cross qp. It was made for. So in fact, what you have is you have a natural injection which is compatible with the action of P of QP of this D tilde inside D across QP. And so the theorem is the following. the theorem that in fact this d tilde is equal to d cross qp pc. And so if you start from the trivial Figama module, you recover the proposition I just wrote. And the second thing, which is more important for us, I mean, both are important, but the second thing is more, is that d tilde plus, in fact, is d natural cross qp pc. So this is exactly what allows you to prove the last theorem I stated at the end of the previous hour. Because if you have this as a topological P of QP module, then what you get, you extract this one. And so it means that you can recover this here. Okay. So if you start from a D, you do something complicated, but you end up with this D tilde plus. And now you would like to know how to recover d from d tilde plus. And so you can do it in many ways. But one way which is easy is that, so what you do is that you extend the scalar to the ring. So, well, maybe I will use Fontaine's notation. So R is the usual Fontaine's ring. For me, it would be, so this one would be E tilde for me, okay? So here you have a phi gamma module. So you extend scalar from W frac R over the ring A tilde QP plus. D tilde plus. And then you take phi equals 1. And what you get is exactly the same thing as V of D. So it's a Galois representation attached to D through Fontaine's equivalence of categories. So in fact, you can classify a Galois representation of GQP either in terms of phi gamma modules over the ring OE or in terms of phi gamma modules over D tilde plus. So there is only one difference, is that if you take phi gamma modules over OE, you get actually an equivalence of categories. Here, there is some small problem because you could have some T torsion because you did not let T be invertible. And so this is going to kill some T torsion modules. So it's not really an equivalence of categories. and this T tilde plus, in fact, you can actually write it. It's going to be W of R. So this would be R e tilde plus in my notation, tensor V of D over ZP. And now what you take is a kernel of the cyclotomic character. So you get that's how you could describe. The E tilde plus is just the R. Yes. I mean, this ring I would call A tilde, and this one I would call A tilde plus in my notation. Okay. Well, I prefer my notations, but. Okay, so that's exactly what allows you to prove the previous statement. And now, well, about what can you say about using duality? Well, that's what I just mentioned before. So using duality, you get the following thing. So if you take some element which is torsion, so phi gamma etal torsion, then what you prove is that D cross QP, sorry, D check natural cross QP Well, this is exactly the Pontryagin dual. So Pontryagin dual, I call off. So you start from d tilde, mod d tilde plus, and you take Pontryagin dual. And so as a corollary, you get that this one is, if d is irreducible, this one is almost irreducible as a topological P of QP vector space. So this is almost, not what I want. D irreducible. I don't want that because I'm torsion. So, and if D is not torsion, so torsion free, phi gamma etal of OE, then what you get is that this is the same thing as D tilde plus mod D, D tilde mod D tilde plus dual. So, continuous ohms into OL. And so that's where I want to say is that this implies that if D is irreducible and dimension bigger than 1 and rank bigger than 2, then this implies that this D tilde mod D tilde plus is almost irreducible. Meaning that if you multiply by, the only irreducible subthings are of finite co-lengths, almost irreducible. If you extend the scalar to L, then it becomes irreducible, almost irreducible as topological PQP module. And so why is it going to be good for us, this kind of thing? Is that so the application to periodic local long lengths is that you will get some exact sequence of the following type. D tilde mod D tilde plus goes to pi of D, goes to D, I think this is something like that. And this is going to be a exact sequence of PQP modules. So we are going to get an exact sequence like that. And so as I told you, this one is very small. If you tensor with L, it's going to disappear. So in fact, you are going to get a complete description of your representation of GL2 of QP in terms of phi gamma modules, okay? And this will serve as a Kirillov model for this. Okay. So I still have 10 minutes, so maybe I start explaining to you what we are going to do. Yes?
I think you said when you take two natural cross QP, then it doesn't have the restriction map, so you don't have a PQP.
Yes, it is true.
But then you seem to be saying things about PQP.
No, what I'm saying is that if I take D natural cross QP, then there is no restriction to open subset. But I have never said anything about restriction to open subsets here.
But I thought you
needed also for getting the PQP action, or you didn't? There is a PQP action. There is a PQP action on any of these modules.
Okay.
You just need a psi. Okay. And on this one, there is a psi. There is no phi, but there is a psi. Okay, and so this is good because, if you know a little bit of phi gamma modules or Fontaine rings, then you know exactly how to handle this kind of thing. And you can extract a lot of information about the open slope GL2 of QP by using this. Okay, so let's start a little bit putting action of GL2 of QP. So up to now it has been quite clean, and now it's going to become a little bit dirty, I'm afraid. Il y a des remarques. So, U and V are supposed to be open subset of, compact open subset of QP. And you say that F is a diffeomorphism. If the following is true, if F is bijective, and is C1, and his inverse is also C1. I think that this is a consequence of the previous two conditions. So I remind you that C1, what does it mean, C1? It means that if you look at f of x plus y minus f of x minus y f prime of x, this is supposed to go to 0 when y goes to infinity, even if you divide by y. So it's like 1 over y times this. This is supposed to go to 0 uniformly on every compact, so uniformly on U. It's not just pointwise. Uniformly for x on U. Okay, so now what we are going to do is define the direct image by a diffeomorphism. Yeah. Y goes to, Well, I was thinking of the PID evaluation of Y. So I want to define, if I have a D, a figure D, then I want to define some map, and I have a morphism. I want to define a map from D cross U to D cross V, which I call F lower star. And so the way this map is constructed, well, you have to go back to measures to discover what the formula should be. And then you put the formula. So let's look at measures. So we start from mu, a measure on ZP. And so the formula you want is the following. You want that the integral of ZP of F star mu of a function is just the integral of ZP. If you have, well, let's stay to start with, I have F diffeomorphism from ZP to ZP, okay? Well, what you want is that this is equal to phi composed with F mu. Okay? Then you apply this to F to phi of X equals 1 plus T to the X. And look at what you get. Okay? So that's the Amis transform. So you want A F etoile mu. So this is going to be, by definition, the integral over ZP of 1 plus T to the F of X mu. And so it's a limit when n goes to infinity of the sum of a set of representative mod P to the n. So that's a set of representative mod P to the n of the integral over I plus P to the n ZP of the same thing, 1 plus t to the f of x mu. Well, here you don't need a limit because I'm just being divided zp into. Well, but now what you do is that you take some Taylor expansion of f of x. So you write that f of x is equal to f of I plus f prime of I times x minus I plus petit o of x minus I, small o. I don't know how you call it in English. And then you replace your f of x. You just ignore that and you put that in. Okay. And then you have something which is affine in x. And so anything that is affine can be described in terms of phi gamma module using multiplication by something. And so what you get that this is the limit when n goes to infinity of sum of I in in. And then, so I give you the formula, final formula. You get something which has the following shape, f prime of I, f of I, 0, 1, times the residue to p to the n zp of 1 minus I, 0, 1, a mu. I skipped some steps, but you just have to do some translations. And this is the action of p plus that is completely described in terms of phi gamma modules. Okay, and in fact, I mean, here it's not so good to use measures because you could also just ignore this step. It would give you the same thing, but in general it will not. And then how do you define this map? You define it exactly by this formula. So you define f star. So f star of z to be, well, so now the in are going to be representative of u mod pi p to the n. So equals the limit n goes to plus infinity of well, f prime of I, f of I, 0, 1, restriction p, sorry, sum I in in. So this is a set of representative of u mod p to the n of the same formula exactly. 1 minus I, 0, 1, z. So here. So the I mean, the proposition is that it has a limit, so exists, so limit exists. And f star is continuous. Z is in D cross U. So, I mean, the hypothesis are these ones. I have a diffeomorphism from U to V. In fact, I don't even need a diffeomorphism. I just need a local diffeomorphism, which means that I just want that f prime does not vanish. I don't need, I mean, to give a meaning to any of these things. I just need f to be. So I put the hypothesis. So f goes from u to v is a local diffeomorphism, meaning that f prime does not vanish. And the statement is that f star of z converges in d cross v if you start from an element in d cross u. Okay, and so I would like to say just one thing about the proof. What do I want to say? Yeah, so there is a small miracle here. Because when you look at these things, so if you start with a z, so this, I remind you, is just phi to the n times psi to the n times 1 plus t to the minus I z. Okay, assume that you are in ZP. Okay. So what happens is that if z is fixed, these things are going to vary in some compact set. So in a compact. And now psi to the n is very nice. It's going to send you everything to these things d sharp. So this belongs to d sharp. If you started with something torsion, if n is big enough. Now there is something which is a little bit problematic, is that this part is very nice, but you have a phi to the n here. And in D sharp, you still have some denominators in T. And this phi to the n is going to blow up your denominators. So that's really a disaster. And so in fact, there is some miracle that happens. You can put the phi to the n outside and show that. So what you prove is that the difference of two things equal to zero. Okay. And to prove that, well, you have the phi to the n and phi to the n plus 1. So you can put phi to the n outside. And you prove that what is inside, thanks to this hypothesis here, goes to 0. And if you have something that goes to 0, phi to the n makes it go to 0 even faster. Right? So you cannot prove directly that this has a limit. You have to take the difference. And then you have to put the phi to the n at a place where it's not going to cause any problem. But there is a small problem in this formula, is that, so I mean, it converges, but it converges extremely badly. So very bad convergence. So in particular, it does not respect over convergent element. So does not respect D dagger. So, I mean, what will happen is that in our cases, D dagger will be respected, but for external reasons, so and not so trivial reasons. And in general, it is not. So this, so in the end, and this formula is nice because it will allow you to prove that the object you are looking for exists, but you cannot do anything with this formula apart proving that it exists. But still, I mean, if you don't have this formula, you don't go anywhere. So, okay, so I stop here for today.